السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. My beloved brothers and sisters, Allah Almighty says in the Quran that He has not kept everyone on the same level of sustenance in terms of the provision that you and I have. Yet He says He will provide for everyone. وَمَا مِن دَابَّةٍ فِي الْأَرْضِ إِلَّا عَلَى اللَّهِ رِزْقُهَا. There is nothing that moves on earth except that the Almighty Allah has taken it upon Himself to provide for it. In one way or another, anything that moves, Allah has taken it upon Himself. I will ensure that this thing is provided for. So you don't need to worry. If Allah takes care of the ants beneath the rocks and the stones and the bricks, then you and I are far bigger than those ants. Do you think He's going to miss us? If Allah has provided for the insects and the birds and the fish in the oceans, do you really think He's going to miss you and I? The difficulty is, you don't realize, and I don't at times, that Allah Almighty is saying that He's going to provide what you need, not necessarily what you want. Big difference. What do you need to survive? Allah says, I've taken it upon Myself to give that to you. You will survive. Whether it is you earning it yourself, or it coming out of the ground for you, or it being given to you by another of our own creatures, we've still provided it to you ultimately. So Allah Almighty says, وَاللَّهُ فَضَّلَ بَعْضَكُمْ عَلَىٰ بَعْضٍ فِي الرِّزْقِ. When it comes to sustenance, Allah has raised some above others as a test. That's what it is. When you have a little bit more than what you need, are you going to dive straight into what you want before you reach out to others who are in need? That's a very important question. Say, for example, and since we are here in London, I'd like to use the pound as an example. Say I have 100 pounds and I need for my survival 50 pounds a day, for example. Before I use my change on what I want, which is over and above what I need, am I going to take a portion of it and reach out to others who are in need? We're not talking about their wants, but their needs. Or am I not going to even think about them? Sometimes Allah Almighty uses you to reach out to others because He has written their provision through your pocket. So if you are going to be dedicated enough to give them from your pocket because Allah put it in your heart to give, then Allah has taken it upon Himself to give you so that He can reach them with what came from what He gave you. Subhanallah. It's not that complicated if you think of it. The point here is, when you pledge to do something for the sake of Allah, Allah opens the doors automatically. I know of youngsters, boys and girls, who've come to me and said, we want to get married, but we can't afford it. Fair enough, that's a good one. But there is an answer in the Quran regarding marriage itself. If you have people who are respectable and they are hardworking, upright, and they are trying their best, you don't need to own a home before you get married. You don't need to own a car before you get married. There are so many people, the majority on earth, perhaps especially in first world countries, the majority of people live in accommodation that is rented that doesn't belong to them. And they may be living in such accommodation for generations. So it doesn't mean you have to own a place. Many fathers would actually ask a young man who comes seeking the hand of their daughter, perhaps, do you own a house? And the guy says, no. If he had the courage, you would say, look at yourself. You only owned one when you turned 50. And you're telling me I'm only 20. I'll do better than you. I'll own one when I'm 45. But they can't. They don't have the guts. The reason is they need to get married to that daughter. I need to say, it's okay. Inshallah, I'm working on that. It's going to happen. It's fine. It's this, it's that, whatever. Fair enough. The point is something different here. When we start demanding things from people in order to get them married without realizing what Allah says, وَأَنْكِحُ الْأَيَامَ مِنْكُمْ وَالصَّالِحِينَ مِنْ عِبَادِكُمْ وَإِمَائِكُمْ. Allah is speaking about marriage. Allah is speaking about getting married. Guess what He says immediately after that? إِنْ يَكُونُوا فُقَرَاءَ يُغْنِهِمُ اللَّهُ مِنْ فَضْلِهِ. If they are poor, Allah, as a result of them getting married, will then provide for them from His own virtue. The term fadl not only refers to virtue, but it refers to excess, that which is more. Imagine, over and above your need. For Allah, He doesn't need a thing. So everything He has is actually more. But Allah says, by virtue of you committing and getting married, Allah will then open your doors for as long as you are responsible. And remember, what sin does, it eats away at your sustenance. So remain vigilant and abstain from sin. When you sin and you don't repent to Allah, it eats away at your sustenance. Look at a lot of wealthy people who don't have at the end of the month or at the end of the week. And yet there are people who earn less than them who have a lot of change. There is no barakah. There is no blessing in what you've earned simply because you're oiling the teeth of a cog that is haram. That's what it is. Either gambling or intoxicants or womenizing or whatever else it is. In the case of women, manizing or whatever you want to call it. May Allah protect us. But it's a reality. If you're using your money and you're wondering that there is no blessing in it, take account of it. Check where you're spending it. Perhaps you may be spending it in that which is in the displeasure of Allah, so the barakah is snatched. But if you cut out all of that, you will notice Allah has given you. Allah has given you more than you need. All of us seated here, if you were to look at the amount of money spent on you from the day you were born, I promise you, in almost all cases, it goes beyond a figure that would actually be mind-boggling, to be honest with you. Millions at times. How much has been spent on you? Subhanallah, Rabbil Alameen. Some of the young must be thinking, I hope they didn't spend it on me. They should have just given it to me now. Well, for you to survive, that's... For you to survive, they had to spend it. That's how you got here today. But my brothers, my sisters, are we thankful? Are we thankful? وَإِن تَعُدُّوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ لَا تُحْصُوهَا إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَظَلُومٌ كَفَّارٌ. If you are to try and count the favors of Allah upon you, you won't be able to count them all. You won't be able to count them all. Indeed, man is not only oppressive, but he's also ungrateful. He does not show gratitude. He forgets the favors of Allah upon him. When we go through difficulty and hardship, sometimes we think to ourselves, Allah's let us down, but we forget the 30 years of our lives when we were provided for without a worry. Subhanallah. Now that I'm tested for 10 years or 5 years, I'm suddenly upset with my maker. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. Don't let that happen. Ayyub alayhi salam was embarrassed to raise his hands in dua when he was sick and ill and when he lost from his children and his health, because the point he said is, if Allah kept me so good for so many years and now that I'm being tested for less than that amount of years, how can I raise my hands and say, oh Allah, here is me complaining? Amazing. But we are not Ayyub alayhi salam. No problem. You can raise your hands and you can ask Allah, but don't become distant from Allah because of your problems. Brothers and sisters, when people go through difficulty and hardship, it is meant to draw a believer closer to the Almighty. Remember that. When people go through difficulty and hardship, it is meant to draw a believer closer to the Almighty. إِنَّ اللَّهَ إِذَا أَحَبَّ عَبْدًا ابْتَلَاهُ. When Allah loves His slave, He tests him or her. And He gives them a great reward. The same problem, a person with no belief in the Almighty will be driven in order to solve it to the pubs and clubs, to the intoxicants and to sin in order to relieve himself. But that actually has the opposite effect and it makes them worse. So think about it. Which is it of the favors of your Lord do you deny? Allah's given you. Sometimes we turn away from Allah. We've stopped praying. We've stopped doing the right thing. So Allah says, but this slave has a good heart, a good soul. This slave I love. So Allah says, out of my love of the slave, I'm going to test them. So that when I send in their direction what is negativity to them, it is actually so positive that it brought them closer to us. So for the first time in your life, you're broken. You're broken. And when you're broken, what happens? Initially, you think you're strong. You think you will solve the problem. Allah breaks you further. And then what happens? You're broken even further. When you realize your helplessness and when you realize the power of Allah and you shed the first tear in your life of helplessness and conviction in Allah, then Allah says, oh, my worshippers, finally come close to me. Yet Allah knew. That's why the hadith says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ إِذَا أَحَبَّ عَبْدًا ابْتَلَاهُ. When Allah loves a slave, He tests him or her. Go back and read the biography of Muhammad, peace be upon him. You will check he was tested more than any one of us because he was the most beloved unto Allah. And that's why some of the scholars have suggested as a solution for the problems or as part of the remedy and part of transformation, part of your therapy when you have a major problem is to read the biography of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. It will help you. As you swim through and as you turn the pages of this biography, you will shed tears to know that the one whom Allah created, whom we call Afdalul Khalqi wa Akramul Rusuli, the most noble of all prophets, the greatest of all creation, Allah tested him to the degree that his own wife at some point said, In kunna ala Muhammadin. You know, when I sit and read this and I tell myself, imagine here is Aisha radiallahu anha, the wife of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We call her the mother of the believers. May Allah be pleased with her. She's saying, even though we were the family of the Prophet, even though we were the family of the Prophet, what does that mean? That means even though we were the family of the most beloved unto Allah, a month passed, we saw the moon. Another moon we saw, and another moon we saw. And in the interim, we had nothing to eat at home besides dates and water. That's the most loved unto Allah. Did they complain once? No, they didn't. What did they do? On top of that, they reached out to others. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave things to the degree that Allah revealed verses to say, when you are giving, don't give that which you desperately need. وَلَا تَجْعَلْ يَدَكَ مَغْلُولَةً إِلَىٰ عُنُقِكَ وَلَا تَبْسُطُهَا كُلَّ الْبَسْطَ. Allah is teaching us moderation in giving. You don't not give at all, hold back like a miser. And you don't just give everything that even what you need is given, subhanallah. But the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, they had a quality in them. They gave even when they needed, subhanallah. Allah praises the people of Medina Munawwara when strangers came to them with the only connection being that of La ilaha illallah. Strangers came to them. The people of Mecca were the people of a different tribe altogether. Among the Indo-Paks, if you're from a different tribe, sometimes the amount of tribalism within us is disgraceful, where we sometimes wouldn't even reach out to others. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. The Muhajirin and Ansar intermarried. If it were us, because of a river somewhere in the subcontinent, we wouldn't do that. Astaghfirullah. What type of jahiliyyah and ignorance is this? Are you not ashamed of yourself? 15 generations back, you are the children of one man. 15 generations down, your great-great-grandchildren. No, they can't. They come from that village. We come from this side. These are political borders, or whatever else it may be. You are a creature of Allah. Be ashamed of yourself if you utter those statements. Racism is not for us. Tribalism is not for us. It is a jahiliyyah. It is an ignorance. We are human beings. We are creatures of Allah. We are believers in Allah. We utter the shahada. Here are the Muhajirin who were literally driven out of their homes in Makkah al-Mukarramah. They had nothing because it was all usurped. As they arrived in Medina, they were welcomed by people who did not know them. How many kilometers away? 400 and something kilometers away. Makkah and Medina. They were welcomed. Are you ready to welcome a stranger? The answer is no. In the case of a lot of us, we're not ready. It's a fact. They welcomed strangers, and you know what? They gave away what they needed. And Allah says, we loved that so much that they were prepared to share. Just the fact that you are prepared to share. Today we're talking about Abdullah Aid. I would never be here if I didn't trust the charity that I'm speaking about. I would never have agreed to be a voluntary ambassador of Abdullah Aid if I didn't know exactly what's going on behind the scenes. I wouldn't. It's never been my way. But we're here because the globe is struggling. People are suffering. We are struggling with something they would consider a luxurious life. We're still not happy. And the people in need, trust me, they would do anything to live your life. You're living a life that you're complaining about, with you and your problems and your complaints and your health matters and your family matters. There are millions on earth who are willing today to take your life completely. They wouldn't mind at all living your life. And you're complaining? Come on, you don't really have problems. You haven't tasted real disaster. May Allah protect us. That's the blessing of Allah. Keep thanking Him. Keep thanking Him, because when you thank Him, you get more. وَإِذْ تَأَذَّنَ رَبُّكُمْ لَإِنْ شَكَرْتُمْ لَأَزِيدَنَّكُمْ. The announcement of Allah. He says, if you are thankful, I will grant you increase in the goodness. And if you are ungrateful, even what you have, perhaps punishment may overtake you. May Allah not do that to us. Ingratitude. Be grateful. Allah's given you. Allah's blessed you. Your problems are just a pinprick in the lives of others compared to theirs. Here are the Sahaba radiallahu anhum. Allah says, وَالَّذِينَ تَبَوَّأُوا الدَّارَ وَالْإِيمَانَ مِنْ قَبْلِهِمْ يُحِبُّونَ مَنْ هَاجَرَ إِلَيْهِمْ. Allahu Akbar. Allah says, describing the Ansar, the people of Medina Munawwara, Allah says, you know what? They opened their homes for strangers and they loved those who came to them, what we would term today as refugees. Subhanallah, they loved them. Look at the globe today. Refugees are looked down upon completely. They are in most cases looked at as a menace or a problem or an issue. Why? The Quran says we are praising those who opened their homes to welcome these people who were driven out of theirs. And they decided, you know what? We love these people. What are we prepared to do for them? Listen to what Allah says. يُؤْثِرُونَ عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ وَلَوْ كَانَ بِهِمْ خَصَاصَةٌ وَمَنْ يُوقَ شُحَّ نَفْسِهِ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ. Allah describes the successful people. Allah says, those Ansar, they gave away what they needed. They favored others over their own need. Subhanallah. They had a quality beyond yours and mine. That's why they were chosen as companions of the Prophet, peace be upon him. There is a hadith where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about how the chosen souls were placed in creation, the most noble from amongst them, and then the next and the next, and he placed the companions exactly where they were. You and I were not companions. Do you know why? I think if we were in the presence of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, perhaps we may not have been as supportive as those who were there. Today, when someone tells you, the Prophet, peace be upon him, said this, are you really interested in what was said? Someone tells you, the Quran says this, are you really interested? Are you prepared to say, sami'na wa ata'na, we hear, we obey. We heard it, we obey it. Or are you going to be from among those who reject? No, hang on, I need a bit of time, man. Come on, it's going to be difficult. What? Is this what you're telling me? No. I need a little bit more time. We're weak. But that's why we have reminders of this nature. My brothers, my sisters, I'm here to tell you, give. Anfiq yabna adama unfiq alayk. Hadith, where Allah Almighty is telling us, hadith Qudsi, spend, O son of Adam, I will spend on you. Give and I'll give you. They gave from what they needed. We are not even saying give from what you need. Give from the excess. A little bit more. What do you have? Give a little bit. Reach out to people. Give more. The more you give, the more you get. I've had the opportunity to visit many places with Abdullah Aid. And we saw firsthand the people, the orphans, those who've lost both parents and some of their limbs at the same time. Little children. Who do they have? لَنَ اللَّهُ وَمَا لَنَا بَعْدَ اللَّهِ أَحَدٌ. We have Allah alone. After Allah, we have no one. We have no one. The world, does it care? It doesn't even care. And we think, subhanAllah, that we have problems. Think about what they're going through. Visit, see. Do you know part of the therapy when you have issues is to help those who have similar or worse issues? It's part of therapy. Help people, go out, see them, visit them, have a soft heart. These are human beings. The other day, I heard someone yell at another, and I knew this brother. Later on, I told him, my brother, the man you yelled at is actually a human being. Humans shouldn't do that to others. Do you know that what you did was a debt next to your name? It's coming back to you. One day, someone will abuse you. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saw one of his companions. May Allah be pleased with all of them. Maltreat one of his servants. And he tapped him and says, do you know Allah has greater authority and control and power over you than you have over this servant of yours? Trembling, he said, this man is free to go. Subhanallah. Meaning, it affected him. He understood and realized immediately that Allah would punish me for what I did. So he made peace instantly. We don't even want someone to correct us. We think we're a big deal. Do you know why? I earn, that's why. I don't depend on anyone. I've got my own place. I've got many places. I've got my cars. I've got my job. I've got my business or whatever else. I'm okay. I'm set. Allah says, hang on. When you had, you didn't give. When we take away from you, you won't be able to give. Do you really think you're going to have forever? The answer is no. Allah has to test you. He has to test you. Do you know what he says in the Quran, in Surah Al-Baqarah, which is the second surah of the Quran? He brought it right to the beginning. He could have kept it near the end. We will indeed definitely emphasized it. We will most definitely test every single one of you. بِشَيْءٍ مِّنَ الْخَوْفِ وَالْجُوعِ وَنَقْصٍ مِّنَ الْأَمْوَالِ وَالْأَنفُسِ وَالثَّمَرَاتِ. We will test every one of you with a little bit of fear, anxiety. You're scared, you're worried. We're going to test you with that anxiety. COVID came in, the most powerful lost their lives. What could they do? Nothing. Do you not agree? Have you seen it happening? Could you breathe your money? No. Could it do anything for you? Zero. We are thankful to Allah. We've arrived at a stage where variants have become light. Restrictions have been opened. Today we are seated here. It is the fadl of Allah. It is the virtue of Allah. If He wants, He can test us with something even worse. So be thankful to Allah. Show gratitude to Allah. Allah says, we will test you with anxiety. No matter who you are, it's going to come. Will you rely on us? Will you turn to us? Will you soften your heart? The tyrant, the Pharaoh, was tested with one after the other. Was he bothered? Not at all. Until the end, when he realized, my life is going. My soul is leaving my body. Then he says, oh, I believe. Too late. Subhanallah. My brothers, my sisters, we are fortunate. Thank Allah. If you're seated here today, or if you're watching this at any time, trust me, you're fortunate. You have a lot. You might not have what you want, but what you need, Allah has already promised He's going to provide it for you. Allahumma lakal hamd. Keep repeating that. Allahumma lakal hamd. Oh Allah, unto you belongs all praise. We thank you for whatever you gave us. Yes, we do have problems. I have issues. You have issues. We all have this, that, health matters, whatever else it may be. But in alhamdulillah, we thank Allah. May Allah help us all through our problems. Pray for one another. You never know. When you pray for someone, the angels are praying for you. Subhanallah. Think about others. And that's why in Islam, everything is connected to what you do. So when you want to receive that contentment and happiness and goodness, or you want mercy of Allah, you need to be merciful to others. You want sustenance, you need to try your best to help others. You want calmness, goodness, you need to be able to facilitate for others as best as you can by speaking to them respectfully, by being good and kind and understanding. And Allah will open your doors. May Allah help us all. We have goodness. Every one of us has goodness in the heart, without a doubt. But sometimes it's just clouded by everything that's going on. It's clouded. So we have a reminder to say, there are people, you know, I wanted to name countries where people are struggling, but I don't think I'm going to do that. Because the list is almost endless. Can you name countries? Think of them in your mind. It's endless. You're going to miss some places. But here we are sitting beautifully, mashallah. And what is it all about? It's all about reaching out. You see, the theme says healing through helping. Ar-Rahimuna yarhamuhumur Rahmanu. Irhamu man fil ardi yarhamkum man fis sama. The merciful are shown mercy. Have mercy upon those on earth, and Allah Almighty will have mercy upon you. Simple. Have mercy. Are you a merciful person? I want to ask every one of us, young and old, male and female, ask yourself, am I merciful? Do I show mercy to those whom destiny has placed next to me in life? I mean Allah. Allah is the owner of destiny. Who is that? Your parents. Are you respectful? Do you show mercy? Your children, your spouse. Subhanallah. Do you show mercy? Or do you think it's okay? I'll fix him up or I'll fix her up, whoever else it may be. I'll fix them. I'll show them. You come in and what was the point? Where did you go? What did you achieve with all this tyranny? What did you achieve by being hard and harsh? People are struggling as a result of your very existence, praying that you die. Do you know that? It happens, right? People pray, I wish this guy could die. I wish this woman could go. Why? For what? Why should they do that about me? I should be such an asset that the people around me pray for me to have good health and a long life so that they can enjoy my company on earth. And they say, may Allah gather us in Jannah. That is a true believer. Wouldn't you like to be that? May Allah make us that. Change your lives. If you are stressing people around you, do you know when people work for you, one of the most important or the biggest gifts you can ever give them is to offer them dignity and respect. To pay them on time, the best gift, that is part of a believer. It's part of his system. Those who work for you, do you offer them respect? Those who work under you, you could be a manager, whatever else it may be, do you talk to them kindly? I've known of people who quit a job even though they need the money, simply because the boss yelled at them, "My brother, would you like someone to do the same to you? It's coming. Maybe in a different way." So make peace in order to avoid that. Respect people. Charity begins at home. That's what it means. What's the point of being the nastiest person you don't even want to spend on your own folks, and the next best thing, you're giving charities all over the world and everyone's praising you, but at home, everyone's scared of you? That needs to change.
إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِقَوْمٍ حَتَّى يُغَيِّرُوا مَا بِأَنفُسِهِمْ.
Allah doesn't change the plight or the condition of a nation unless and until each individual changes himself or herself. Are you determined? Would you like to become a better person? The answer is yes, in all of us. I'd like to think we're good enough to admit, including myself, I need to become a better person, no matter what. How do I become better? Become conscious of Allah, your maker. Understand, where were you some time back? You know, in Surah Ad-Dahr, Allah Almighty, and in Surah Yasin, Allah Almighty reminds us of where we were before.
هَلْ أَتَى عَلَى الْإِنسَانِ حِينٌ مِّنَ الدَّهْرِ لَمْ يَكُنْ شَيْئًا مَذْكُورًا.
Allahu Akbar. Has a time not passed? Sometime during, you know, for man, where he was not even something mentioned. Subhanallah. Where were you? If you're 50 years old, where were you 55 years ago? Where were you? And Allah words it beautifully in Surah Yasin. You know what he says?
أَوَلَمْ يَرَ الْإِنسَانُ أَنَّا خَلَقْنَاهُ مِنْ نُطْفَةٍ فَإِذَا هُوَ خَصِيمٌ مُبِينٌ.
Does man not see that we created him from a droplet of semen? And suddenly, he springs up argumentative. He doesn't realize, where were you? You're standing and arguing and fighting and causing problems and issues. But brother, a few years ago, you were a droplet. Subhanallah. Allah's telling you that in the Quran to remind you, man, remember where you were and remember where you're going. In the interim, just prepare. Prepare for what? Prepare for the return to Allah. By doing good deeds while you are here, you are going to take nothing with you. I met a very wealthy man. I told him, what do you like to do in this world? What is it that really gives you a kick? It's a beautiful question. I want to know, because I know what gives me a kick. When I say a kick, I'm sorry, I'm not talking about anything intoxicating here. But we're talking about what makes me, what happy, excited. He said, wallahi, I tell you, the more I spend in a good cause and charities, the more I feel Allah has accepted me. Subhanallah. The more I spend, he says, I've earned billions. As I earn, I spend. And I love to spend. It's as though Allah has entrusted me with more than I ever need so that I can reach out to those who don't. I was inspired. So inspired. And I said, Allah has kept this not only in money, but in anything beneficial, starting with knowledge. If Allah has blessed you with knowledge, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, بَلِّغُوا عَنِّي وَلَوْ آيَةٌ. Don't be stubborn and stingy. Convey from me, even if you know one thing, one verse, convey it. Tell others, remind them in a beautiful way. Sometimes the way you talk to others means more than the contents of it. Because sometimes if you have powerful content, but you've delivered it in a harsh way, people will run away from you. That's also in the Quran. So you need to develop methods. You need to understand and learn the situation or the environment or the people, their struggles. Put yourselves in their shoes for a while and see how they are struggling before you open your mouth. Don't doom people. But at the same time, reach out to them as best as you can with whatever goodness Allah's given you. If Allah's given you, for example, a gift of maybe some discipline, some sport, something else that you have, something you believe would be beneficial, your time can also be a gift. Spend time with others. At home, what do they want from you? Sometimes they don't want much. They just want you to spend a Sunday morning with them. They want you to sit with them, spend a bit of time. People are hardworking. They leave home early morning, they come back in the evening. When I come back, I shouldn't be immersed in my device. The wife says, I wish I was a phone. Why? Because you'd hold me all day. Subhanallah. Allahu Akbar. Look at me and smile. Look at me and laugh. Imagine. Subhanallah. Well, that's if you were a Samsung. My brothers, my sisters, really, when I traveled with Abdullah Aid, I saw what I hadn't seen before. And even though we were fulfilling this duty on behalf of yourselves, and we are here to say Jazakumullahu khayran, may Allah recompense you with goodness, your donations, your charities were taken, not 100%, more than 100%. If you want to know how, you can go to the website. Say, if you gave 100 pounds, perhaps 110 pounds was used on your behalf. Go and find out how. We did it. Meaning, they did it. Perhaps brother Masihullah can explain to you later how that was the case. And then it was given on your behalf. And not just ordinarily, what do you want? We need this. Okay, we're going to do it. Where are you from? We are here on behalf of the people of London. Allahu Akbar. And then these people, somewhere in the corner of the globe, are saying, Subhanallah, look at this. Allah has sent to us people who've never met us, never seen us, never ever had any interactions with us. We're not going to benefit them in any way. We can't give them back anything besides a dua and a supplication and a good prayer. But they're here. Helping. Congratulations. May Allah accept your efforts. This is the goodness. This is where we are to say, Alhamdulillahi ala kulli hal. So many good deeds. There are people struggling who didn't have eyesight. Hundreds of cataract operations came from you. May Allah accept it from you. People who needed crutches, simple crutches. Thousands of them were given. Wheelchairs. People needed homes. Villages were built. Subhanallah. Oh, how? Because Allah accepted your wealth. That's how. What else happened? So much more. Volcanoes erupted. People from all over helped. Abdullah Aid was there. What were they doing? Delivering. On whose behalf? Yours. So while you're sitting enjoying, you're sipping away your Sunday morning tea and having your breakfast, your reward is clocking. Guess what? Was it not a gift of Allah that Allah created people who were honest around you and hardworking enough to do a favor, to do you a favor, to take your charities and donations with all accountability and fulfill it in the best possible way for you, with your name on there? Subhanallah. When I went into one of the villages and I was walking down some of these passages, and I started looking at the names, and I noticed, wow, the name is written of the donor. Some of them say, anonymous brother, anonymous sister, fair enough, but it's good to write your name sometimes, because later on, one day, one of your children or progeny or whoever else it may be, they may just look at that and say, wow, hey, that's my grandfather, man. Oh, that's my father, you know? And they'll be encouraged to do more. You see? Or the people praying for you would actually pray by name. By name. It's good sometimes. It sent a shiver down my spine to see names of people I know. Some of them young, 18 years old. I see the name there. Wow, subhanAllah. This unit donated by so-and-so. What did it cost? 1,500 quid. SubhanAllah. And I'm thinking, must have been saving, and said, you know what? These people need it. I guarantee you, ma naqasa malun min sadaqa. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, nobody's wealth was ever depleted because of a charity they gave. Allah gave them more. Give. Allah will give you. For me to be standing in front of you to say, listen guys, I would not associate with a charity easily. I haven't done it for the last 2 decades. Why suddenly? Because the world has become in greater need, and we needed to look for someone with integrity. And by all means, I'm not belittling the others. But I know, for me, Abdullah Aid did it. I loved the transparency. I loved the attitude. And I loved the fact that they weren't boasting and bragging about what was happening, but it was happening. And if they couldn't do it, they would tell you straight, listen, we can't do this. That was beautiful. More than anything else, they spent more than you gave on the cause that you gave for. May Allah Almighty accept it from everyone. May Allah bless you all and grant you all goodness. Like I say, you need help, help others. You will heal through helping. Do you know that part of your therapy, like I said, is to read from the Quran, from the Sunnah. Read what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam went through. It is therapeutic for you. It's healing for you to go through the seerah and the life of the most blessed, bearing in mind he was the most blessed. He had difficult days. He thanked Allah. He says, oh Allah, if you're pleased with me, everything else is okay. It's by the way. SubhanAllah. SubhanAllah. We lose hope. I had a sister with a terminal illness. May Allah grant cure to all those who are sick and ill. Say, but Allah doesn't love me. I said, no, he does. Imagine he's giving you a heads up to say, prepare. Imagine if he just took you one big bang, bash, and you're gone without even thinking, am I going, am I not going? Isn't it a blessing to have a little illness where people are telling you you're going to die? You don't know whether you may or not, because so many were told that they're going to die and they're still alive sitting amongst us right here today. Right? But at least you could turn to Allah a little bit. It was okay. If Allah gives you older age, it's a blessing, because you know, you start doing istighfar. It's the ending that matters, not the beginning. No matter what you did in the past, you scored your own goals and the score is 10-0 against you. But as you grow older, you started scoring more and more and more, and you wiped out all the others and everything, and you die on a good condition. Allah says, you know what? You are judged by the ending, just like a football match according to us. You don't just look at the score at the beginning and say they've lost. You wait until the whistle is blown. At that point, what was the score? Then you know. No matter how old you are, don't worry about the past. The past is exactly that. It's history. What about now? Right now. So we earn Jannah. Some people earn Jannah through various means. Whatever Allah's given you. Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu was a wealthy man. You know, in our circles, we refer to him as Uthman Ghani. Why? Because he was rich. He was rich. He was a rich man. Do you know that on more than one occasion, the Prophet ﷺ said, whoever does the following in terms of a monetary charity will be given paradise. And he did it. Sometimes there's a need. You know, you give to that need. It's not going to be easy for me, but inshallah, I'm going to try and I'm going to get this done. You see how Allah opens your doors. But the condition is remain humble. You know, the test is humility. Allah loves those who are humble. When He gives you power, authority, wealth, whatever else it may be, good looks, you know, a position, whatever else it may be, are you humble or have you changed in a negative way? If you change in a negative way, you've lost. You lost. Because Allah has given more than what He gave you to others, and they are humble. What He gave them drew them closer to Allah. So why should what He gave me drive me away from Him? So inshallah, with this I pray, my brothers and sisters, that we can be motivated to do good and to do more good, and to look at our own hearts and our conditions and tell ourselves we are blessed. We're really blessed, all of us. And our problems, yes, they're there. But when we reach out to those who have problems similar to ours or worse, Allah will grant us a healing like never before. We feel reassured. You know, you didn't have shoes. You were slightly ungrateful until you saw someone without feet. Subhanallah. Then you said, forget about my shoes, at least I have feet. That's what it is. انظروا إلى من هو دونكم. Look at those who have less than you, who are below you in terms of worldly matters. And when it comes to faith, it's the other way around. Look at those who are doing more than you. You pray 5 times a day, look at those who do their sunnah and their nafil, meaning that which is voluntary, over and above the 5 compulsory prayers. Look at those who get up for tahajjud all the time. Be motivated. Tell yourself, they did it, I'm going to do it. Who are you doing it for? For your maker. We are Muslims. We are fortunate. We worship none other than He who made us. May Allah accept it from all of us. Once again, may Allah reward every one of you who have donated to any cause, not necessarily only this charity, but any other charity as well, any good cause. Sometimes it comes to you in front of your face. You got to do it yourself sometimes. A person comes asking you, sometimes you see a cause, you may give, it's fine. Use your discretion in a beautiful way. But the idea is to be able to be used to do good. And I want to end by saying one thing. A gift of Allah is something known as the scale of the Day of Judgment. Yes, it's scary, but it's a gift. Do you know why it's a gift? Before I tell you why, let me quickly describe this scale. So your good deeds and bad deeds are going to be weighed on the Day of Judgment. I said that's a gift. Why is it a gift? Because Allah says that what you've repented from is wiped out completely. It's not even going to go on that scale. When you died, the amount of bad that you have that you didn't repent from is what we're talking about. And then Allah says we're going to put that on the left side of the scale. And we won't just cast you into hellfire because of the bad you did. If you did more good than bad, we will ignore the bad and still grant you paradise, although you had bad that you did. That's why the scale is a blessing. When your good deeds are more than your bad, we're insan, we're human. We all commit sin. But not out of defiance of the Almighty, out of human weakness. Human weakness commits sin. I'm not encouraging or promoting it, I'm just mentioning a fact. Adam alayhi salam, say what you want, but Allah Almighty told him not to do just one thing, and that's exactly what he went to do. Can you imagine? See the nature of mankind. But the difference is he immediately regretted it, and he immediately sought forgiveness, and Allah says, I've forgiven you. There goes. So on the scale, there's good and bad. You did bad deeds, yes, fair enough. What I know about that is, it was not out of defiance of Allah, it was weakness. And you sought forgiveness, it's wiped out. But if you died without seeking the forgiveness, it's put on the scale. When your good deeds come on, and they are more than your bad, Allah says, you know what? فَمَنْ ثَقُلَتْ مَوَازِينُهُ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ Those whose good deeds on the scale are heavier are the truly successful. May Allah grant us success. Imagine if it wasn't for that scale and we were punished for all the bad we did before we went into paradise. We would all be tasting some heavy punishment. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala truly have mercy on us. Yes, there is a small warning about the weight of bad deeds. Don't underestimate it. Sometimes a small thing you think is minor, but in the eyes of Allah, it's very big. You need to be careful, especially when you hurt others. One day there was something said about someone in the presence of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam about them being a little bit this way and that way in terms of their physical features. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "Wallahi, if your statement was a droplet of ink placed in the ocean, it would change the color." Meaning, hey, don't think it's a minor thing. It's major. The accusation in the Quran that's made mention of the people who made an accusation against Aisha radiallahu anha, they accused her of whatever they did. May Allah protect all of us. Allah says, تَحْسَبُونَهُ هَيْنًا وَهُوَ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ عَظِيمٌ. You think it's minor, but in the eyes of Allah, it's major. So may Allah forgive all our shortcomings and grant us goodness. I've spoken for my 50 minutes on the button. Barakallahu feekum. May Allah bless you all. Jazakumullah khaira. Qulu qawli hadha wa sallallahu wa sallama wa baraka ala nabiyyina.